So as we're kind of getting there, verse 1 through 13 is where we're going to be this morning. I want to just bring back to mind where we've been, because context is so important, especially in light of our passage this morning. So if you remember, a few weeks ago, we talked about how Jesus really dropped this this bomb on his disciples in a way, because they were anticipating this coming Messiah, and they were anticipating what he was going to do. He was going to establish this earthly kingdom. He was going to overthrow Rome, and he was going to basically bring Jerusalem and the people of Israel back to a place of prominence, and really kind of make them the center of the world. It was where kings would come and bow down before the Messiah, the great king that was going to establish his kingdom. So Jesus asks them, hey, you know, what's the public opinion of me? Who do you guys say that I am? Well, you're the Christ. You're the one who is supposed to do all of that for us. And then, again, Jesus kind of drops this truth bomb on them, and he said, yeah, I am he, but it's not what you're expecting. The Messiah actually is going to suffer, be rejected, and be killed, and then is going to rise on the third day. And so they're just kind of confused. They're kind of dumbfounded. This is why Peter speaks up, and he's like, you know, no way, this is not going to happen to you. That's impossible. That's not what we've been told is going to happen. They were shocked, right? And then if that wasn't enough, Jesus told them then, if you want to follow me, then you need to enter into that road of suffering and rejection with me. That's what it's going to take. That's what it's going to require for you to follow me. And not only that, but you have to willingly do it, consciously do it, and be ready for whatever comes. So this is the disciples' state of confusion, right? This is what they thought. This is what Jesus said. This is where they probably are now. Like, what is going on? This doesn't make sense. It's not what we've been told. And then we enter Mark chapter 9, and we're in verse 1 through 13. Let's just start with verse 1, right? So Mark 9, and he, Jesus, said to them, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God after it has come with power. All right, so let's just pause there for a second and talk about this. So at first, it can sound a little bit confusing, right? Like, some of you are not going to die until you see the kingdom of God and all its power. Well, how is that possible, right? It kind of sounds like what Jesus is saying is that the kingdom of God is coming soon, and the disciples, some of them who are present, would actually see it in their lifetime. But I thought he just told them that that's not really how it was going to happen. So what is Jesus talking about, right? That can't be really even a right interpretation for us today, because the kingdom of God has still not yet come, as Jesus is kind of alluding to. So what is he saying? What is he referring to? Well, most scholars would agree that actually what Jesus is referring to here is the transfiguration, which is the passage we're going to read this morning. The transfiguration, which we'll read about in just a moment. But what we'll see in this story is, as one commentator puts it, is a visible type of eschatological, which is just end times. So a visible type of the end times coming of the kingdom. Right, that's kind of what we see a little bit in this story this morning, is we see this kind of this taste of what is to come, and Jesus being the king of that coming kingdom. So actually, Mark 9:1, those of you who are standing here, some of you will not taste death until they see the kingdom of God. He's actually referring to what they're about to see here in just a few short days. And that's what verse 1 means. So the interpretation makes most sense given the context surrounding the account, as well as the truth that some of the disciples were witness to it. All right, so let's read about it. Let's look at this transfiguration story. And really, this is kind of the pinnacle of this transition from ministry of showing his power by miracles and by his teachings to now showing why he came, right? Like, the teaching now shifts from here's who I am to here's why I'm here. Here's the purpose. Everything now is on his way to Jerusalem. And so this is kind of the pinnacle of it, and then it's going to start moving towards Jerusalem after this. And so let's read Mark 9, 2 through 13. Let's read this whole account, and then let's look at some of what this reveals about Jesus. Verse 2, after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. And there appeared to them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter said to Jesus, Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make 3 tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah. For he did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud. "This is my beloved son, listen to him." And suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone with them but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, he charged them to tell no one what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what this rising from the dead might mean. And they asked him, "Why do the scribes say that first Elijah must come?" And he said to them, "Elijah does come first to restore all things. And how is it written of the Son of Man that he should suffer many things and be treated with contempt? But I tell you that Elijah has come, and they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written of him." Now, that last little bit there might be a bit confusing, but we'll get there and kind of explain what Jesus is saying. But instead of a big idea, there's just this big question that I have for us this morning. All right, what does the transfiguration reveal about Jesus? So this is kind of the big idea. You can rephrase it if you want to make it a statement and said, the transfiguration reveals a lot about Jesus. I don't know, but you can put it as a question, right? So what does the transfiguration reveal about Jesus? Well, number one, the first thing that we see that it reveals is his glory. This is verses 2 and 3. We see that it reveals his glory. Now, Peter and James and John, they're kind of considered the inner circle. They experience a lot more with Jesus in some of these intimate settings. They were there when he raised the girl from the dead. And so Jesus takes these three men up to the top of this mountain. Now, remember, at this point, they had seen the power that Jesus had through the miracles that he performed, through the walking on water, through the casting out of demons, right? He calmed the storms, all of those things. But there was still some confusion over the depth of who he really was, right? That's what we saw as Peter kind of confronts him with what he thought. And Luke tells us in his account that while they were there, they were actually in and out of sleep. So the disciples were, it says they were very, very sleepy. They were falling asleep while all this was happening. And then they wake up to see Jesus, Elijah, and Moses. Now, we don't know how they know it's them. Because, you know, maybe Jesus told them, you know, how would they know? I mean, I think Elijah died 500 something years and Moses, you know, 1,000 years or something before this happened. Like, it's been a long time, maybe thousands. So how would they know? We don't really know that. Also, one kind of side little fact, I mean, it's so interesting to me when you read these passages and you really start to think about the truth behind it, because if they were there present, that means they were there in body form, but when you go to heaven, your spirit ascends to heaven, and we don't get the glorified bodies until the second coming of Christ. And so where did they get these bodies? Was it a temporary body? Was it like, hey, here's a little body shell for you while you go talk to Jesus for this short time? Like, where did they get their bodies? I don't know. But that's not important. That's just kind of that's an interesting thought. So they're falling asleep, right? Can you imagine waking up and this is what you see? This is what you experience, right? Like, they become fully awake, Luke says. And when they were, they saw Jesus transfigured before them. Now, this word transfigured is the Greek word metamorpho, which sounds like metamorphosis, all right? We know that word, which most well known would be caterpillar, right? Like, that's when you think of metamorphosis, it's a caterpillar that goes into its little cocoon and then it comes out as a beautiful butterfly, right? That's the concept of metamorphosis. Now, in its truest sense, the word metamorpho, the Greek word, means an inward condition which produces an outward expression which proceeds from and is representative of the inward character and nature. So in other words, it's an outward expression of what's on the inside. Plain and simple. So there's character, there's nature on the inside. Metamorpho would say that that is somehow externalized and viewed on the outside. Now, that's what that word means. Listen to these passages. John 17:5 says, "And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed." So this is in the high priestly prayer in John 17. Jesus existed in eternity past. Jesus has no beginning in his true self. Of course, we see the beginning as he's born into this world as a human, but Jesus has always existed in eternity past with God and with the Holy Spirit. God the Father, the Holy Spirit, they were all together, and he existed in fullness of glory. So that is what he is consists of, right? Glory. Philippians 2, 6, and 7 says, who Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. He emptied himself of his position in heaven, but he did not empty himself of his glory. So he had existed in glory from the beginning of time. And then he came to this earth in the form of a servant, and he gave up his position in heaven, but he maintained the glory because he was God in flesh. And so 6 days after the disciples are thrown this curveball of suffering Messiah, Jesus reveals to them what is on the inside. He is transfigured before them. It says his clothes became radiant, so bright that Mark says no amount of bleach on the earth could get you that white. Like that's the purity of white that was what they were seeing. Matthew adds that his face shone like the sun. I mean, what a moment for these disciples, right? And all the confusion, they're still trusting that Jesus is the Messiah. They've been thrown this curveball, and now they get to see not the fullness of the glory, because no one can look on God and live, but they see a glimpse of what's on the inside of Jesus. They see a glimpse of his glory. Revelation 21, we dig in a little bit here, right? And we see what this is kind of foreshadowing in a way. Revelation 21 speaks of this future kingdom. In verse 23 and 24 of Revelation 21, John writes, "And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk." And then he continues in 22:5, "And night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever." The future kingdom will have no need for a sun, have no need for a moon in the night. There won't even be a night, because the glory of God will illuminate the whole earth. Right? When God recreates the new heaven and the new earth, and we walk on it and worship him in our glorified bodies, we will not have any need, because the glory of God is so bright, it is so resilient, it is so illuminating that we have no need for any other source of light. And that's what Jesus contains in his body as a human being. He doesn't lose any of that glory. He doesn't lose any of that power. And so, I mean, again, just imagine these disciples waking up and seeing just a glimmer, a taste of what the glory that Jesus holds within. I mean, it just, we could talk about this like all morning, the glory of God. But here's the crazy thing, okay? It goes even further, all right? Philippians, Paul tells us that our lowly bodies will be transformed into glorious bodies. So the glory that Jesus holds, we're not going to have the glory of deity, but our bodies will be transformed into a glorified body, right? Listen to C.S. Lewis, what he says in his book, The Weight of Glory. He says, this is so awesome to me, "The dullest and most uninteresting person you can talk to may one day be a creature which, if you saw it now, you would be strongly tempted to worship." The most boring person that you could talk to now, if they are a follower of Jesus, one day will be so glorified in their body that you would look at them and go, "Oh my goodness, you are incredible." I mean, it's just, you think about this, and they got to see it. Like, we're not supposed to be jealous and envious, but like, if there's a moment in time that I could just sit and watch and see Jesus be glorified, like transfigured before them, man. Now, we could talk about this all morning, but we got to move on, all right? We got three more points to talk about. But the glory of God, all right? It reveals his glory. What else does it do? What else does it show us? Well, it shows us his fulfillment of the law and the prophets. This is number two. So the transfiguration shows us Jesus' fulfillment of the law and the prophets. And this is in verses 4-6. So why Elijah? Why Moses? Why are they the ones who are present? So the Jewish people would associate Moses with the law, right? He was the one that God used to bring freedom to Israel. He was the one that the law was given to on the mountain. He's the one that wrote the law down. And that law became the way of life for the Jewish people, right? The Pentateuch, the first five books, were written by Moses, and that was basically their gospel. Like, this is our scripture. These first five books are the most important, still is to this day. So Moses is the law. Like, they hear his name, and they immediately associate him with the law. Now, Elijah, on the other hand, he was representative of the prophets. And we've talked a few times about how Malachi 4 is you know, this fulfillment of, or this prophecy of Elijah coming back and bringing the hearts of fathers and children back together, reuniting families. So Elijah is a pretty big player on the prophetic scene back in the day, and his prophecies are a lot of what come true in Jesus. So Elijah would be equated to the prophets. And this moment here is really a fulfillment of Malachi 4 that we've been talking about a little bit. Elijah is going to return, this is what it says, before the great day of the Lord, which is future judgment. But both of these men, Moses and Elijah, had these mountaintop experiences with God, and now both of these men are back on the mountain with Jesus. Physically, like physically present. They're not spirits, they're not visions. It says that they woke up and saw these men standing with Jesus. And we see in Luke that they were standing around talking about Jesus' departure when he got to, when he accomplished his mission in Jerusalem. So they're standing around talking about when Jesus eventually gets to Jerusalem, dies, and then completes his mission when he raises from the dead, and then he ascends into heaven. And Peter just doesn't know what to do. And what we see with Peter is when he doesn't know what to do, he opens his mouth, right? Look at verse 6 again, or verse 5. And Peter said, "Rabbi, it's good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you and one for Moses and one for Elijah." He's terrified, right? He doesn't know what to say. "I got to say something. This is really uncomfortable. I'm scared. I don't know what's going on." And usually in those moments, like, here's a freebie, just don't say anything, all right? But he wants to, here's what's going on, right? He wants to cherish this moment. He does not want this moment to end. And so he interrupts Jesus. Like, Jesus is talking to Moses and Elijah, and Peter's like, "Hey, Jesus, sorry. What would you think about, like, us building a couple of booths for you guys to kind of just stay in for a few nights, you know, because this is pretty awesome." In fact, when he says it's good that we're here, the word's actually beautiful. Like, this is beautiful. It's such a beautiful experience. Like, I don't want it to, can we just stay for a little bit longer? And so, you know, and it's funny too, like, Jesus doesn't even say anything. He doesn't answer him. But he's like, "Man, I just want to stay here. I don't want this moment to end." But again, we have to dig a bit deeper to really get to our second point, all right? Like, we got to understand the implication of Moses and Elijah, why the law and the prophets being represented. Well, in Matthew 5:17, Jesus says, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them." In other words, I haven't come to do away with them, he says, "but I came to fulfill them. I came to bring them to completion," in other words. That's what Jesus says in Matthew 5. The law was no longer necessary because Jesus brought a new covenant by his blood, right? Like, freely given to those who believe. It's a new way of gaining, not salvation, because it's always been faith, but like gaining a right standing with God. But now there's no sacrificial system needed. We don't need that anymore. We don't need the law, and we don't need those laws to tell us what we're doing right and wrong necessarily. And then, you know, the weekly and monthly and yearly sacrifice, like, Jesus does away with all of that. And then Jesus also brought to completion hundreds of prophecies. And he gave us the complete word of God through his Spirit. And Jesus brought all of this to completion, the law and the prophets. He says, "I didn't come to do away with it. They're still important, but they are complete. Because what I come to do is a once and for all mission, event, accomplishment, all of the above," right? So Jesus brings it to completion. So these disciples, confused by the idea of Messiah, who is he really? They're being shown the true nature of why Jesus had come. Moses, Elijah, law and prophets, Jesus, the one bringing to completion their ministries, and they get to witness all of it, right? Brings it all to completion. All right, so number three, what else do we see? We also see Jesus' authority as the Son of God. We see that he has authority as the Son of God. This is in verse 7. Let's look at that again. And this is so cool. A cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud. This is my beloved Son. Listen to him. All right, sounds familiar maybe? When Jesus got baptized and the heavens opened and the Lord spoke, said a very similar thing. This is my Son with whom I am well pleased. Maybe it takes your mind back a little bit further. The cloud descending, Exodus 33. When Moses entered the tent, the pillar of cloud would descend and stand at the entrance of the tent, and the Lord would speak with Moses. In 2 Chronicles 5, when the ark was brought into the temple, verse 13 and 14 say, the house of the Lord was filled with a cloud, so that the priest could not stand to minister because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of God. A cloud descended on Mount Sinai in Exodus 19. It says, now Mount Sinai was wrapped in smoke because the Lord had descended on it in fire. So there is great significance in a cloud descending. When we see that in the Old Testament, that was a symbol, but also the truth that God was descending in the cloud to speak to a prophet, to speak to a leader, to speak to the people. And so the cloud that comes is not just like a New Testament thing at the baptism and in this moment, but we see it all throughout the Old Testament. God would descend in a cloud. There's great significance there. And God told them in Moses in Exodus 19, I'm coming to you in a thick cloud. Like he says it. This is how I'm going to make it happen. This is how I'm going to speak to you. And I'm doing it this way because I want people to hear when I speak with you. And they may also believe you forever. So I'm gonna do this visibly because it's going to, one, give them confidence in that I'm real and that I'm trustworthy, but also I want them to have confidence in you and in what you tell them. And so think about the parallel there to Moses. And now when the clouds descend on this mountain and what he says about Jesus, right? Again, remember the confusion, right, surrounding the suffering Messiah, difficulty believing it to be true, and then this voice thunders from heaven, this is my Son, this is the Son of God, and he says, listen to what he tells you, listen to him. And while this is a monumental moment, there's still some encouragement for us, I think, as believers, in the fact that even with these experiences, the disciples still struggled to believe, right? Peter is present here. And who's the one that denies Jesus three times? Peter, right? No, I don't know that guy. No, I don't know. I don't know what you're talking about. And after everything he's seen, after everything he experienced, Jesus gets arrested and he goes, sorry. So I take some encouragement in that. Like these guys who experienced all of this, but yet still until the crucifixion, really until they saw him resurrected, wouldn't fully believe in who he was. So they're coming down the mountain, and Jesus tells them not to tell anybody about what they experienced until after the resurrection. I mean, imagine trying to keep that to yourself. I mean, it's like when someone has a secret, okay, this drives me nuts. You ever have someone that's like, man, you'll never guess what happened? Like, what? Well, I can't tell you, but it was crazy. And you're like, come on, man. I had a friend in college that something happened to him in college, and he was like, dude, the craziest thing happened. I was like, all right. He's like, but I literally can't tell you until we graduate. And I'm like, that's like 3 years, man. You can't. And he literally waited in like 3 years to tell me, and I don't even remember what it was. It wasn't even that cool. But like, that's the worst. Like, dude, something crazy happened. You're going to have to wait, though, right? Like, these guys had something that a once-in-a-lifetime experience, it's the only time it's ever happened in history, they saw it, and they can't tell a soul, right? Just the three of them. And so they're coming down off the mountain, and they're talking to one another, because at least they can talk, they at least have each other, right? And they're talking about, though, it says, they're talking about this idea that Jesus would be raised from the dead. And so they're talking about it. Like, what do you guys think he means by that? How is that going to happen? Like, when, what, like, what, you know? And as they're talking, another question arises, which they ask Jesus in verse 11. He asked him, why do the scribes say that first Elijah must come? That's the question they ask. And let's actually read 12 and 13 again as well. And Jesus answered, he said to them, Elijah does come first to restore all things. And how is it written of the Son of Man that he should suffer many things and be treated with contempt? But I tell you that Elijah has come, and they did to him whatever they pleased, as it is written of him. All right, so here's the fourth thing that we see. The fourth thing that the transfiguration reveals as they're coming off the mountain is that he must suffer before glory. He must suffer. So, okay, we get this glimpse into the glory of Jesus and the coming kingdom, but first, there must be suffering. I mean, it's a pretty logical question that they ask, right, after they what they just experienced. Why do the scribes say that that Elijah's going to come before the Messiah? So Jesus explains, like, they're right. The scribes are right. The scriptures are correct. Elijah does come first. And by the way, the coming of Elijah is a spiritual coming. This is Malachi 4, in which the hearts of people will be brought to repentance. But the day that the Messiah comes is the day of the Lord. So there's these two times, right? Like, one of them is a spiritual reconciliation in which the Elijah brings about this truth. And then you have when the Messiah comes is the day of the Lord, which is the second coming, the future judgment. So we have not had that happen yet. But there's more meaning to it if we dig a little deeper again. Like, this is one of those passages you have to really read deep down into it and pull from other passages to see what all is going on here. The same scriptures that prophesy that Elijah is coming before the Messiah tell us that the Messiah is going to suffer. So what Jesus is saying is basically, they're right, okay? The scriptures are correct. Elijah is going to come. And if those same scriptures, you believe them for Elijah, then you must also believe what they say about the Son of Man, that he should suffer many things and be treated with contempt. So if you believe I'm the Messiah, like you say you do, and the scriptures say that I'm going to suffer, then that is what's going to happen. So they're asking this question. He says, look, they're right. Elijah's going to come, but they're also right that the Messiah has to suffer and also be, held in contempt, right? Treated with contempt. By the way, Jesus says, now this is where it can get a little confusing, okay? So there is this spiritual coming of Elijah, and there is the day of the Lord in which Jesus will come back. Okay, that's one of the truths. But there's another piece of it that we need to look at as well. Jesus says, by the way, Elijah has already come. You go, well, how is that possible if he's supposed to come eventually? Like, how is he going to come, but he's already come? How does that all make sense? Well, Luke tells us that John the Baptist would go as a forerunner before him, Jesus, in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the fathers back to the children, and the disobedient to the attitude of the righteous so as to make a people prepared for the Lord. So you have this truth that there will be a coming of Elijah before the day of the Lord. Not sure how all that works. But you also have this truth that John the Baptist is referred to in prophecy as Elijah. And then Luke tells us that he is thought of as Elijah in a way because he comes in the spirit and power of Elijah. So there's this connection there as well. And when Jesus says that they did to him whatever they pleased in verse 13, what he's talking about is John the Baptist suffering, being arrested, and them doing to him whatever they pleased. Imprisonment, beheading, all of those things. And so there's kind of a dual meaning here in what Jesus is saying, but I want to sum it up from this commentary on Mark that I was reading, because I think this is a good, simple way to think about it. The biblical pattern is clear. Elijah was rejected and persecuted. Messiah's forerunner, who came in the spirit and power of Elijah, was rejected and killed. And Messiah himself was rejected and murdered. In the future, however, the prophesied Elijah will come, the Lord Jesus Christ will return, and the kingdom will be established. So there's kind of a two-part meaning. Does that make sense? You guys kind of see how he's talking about that? I know it can be kind of confusing, especially when there's multiple meanings behind it. All right, let's talk about what this means for us today, all right? So we got the big question at the beginning, but let's ask another question application-wise. What does the transfiguration mean for us today? What does it mean for us today? And we could go a lot of different ways with this, I think. But I think it can also be a difficult question to answer because that was a very specific moment that was telling those disciples a very specific thing. And yes, we have it recorded because Peter witnessed it. Peter gave Mark the account. Mark wrote it down. But it's a hard thing for us sometimes to look at some of these stories and go, okay, so what about us? Because we don't behold the glory of Jesus as they did. Right? We do look at him as glorious, and we do, of course, believe that, but we don't see it like they saw it. We one day will. We can marvel at the aspects of his glory. I mean, we should marvel at the aspects of his glory. We should be found in awe and wonder at his magnificence. Yep. We should be you know, on our knees in awe and wonder at who he is. Of course, you know, the second point, we should be thankful that he came to fulfill the law and prophets. I mean, for sure. Because he ushered in a new covenant of his blood, so now we don't have a sacrificial system that we have to follow. We don't have laws, 613 of them that we have to follow. He brought to completion those things, right, that required the weekly, monthly, yearly sacrifices. Jesus took the sin of the world, past, present, and future, to the cross, and once and for all became the perfect sacrifice that was needed as a once all and for all free way to salvation. It's a free gift that is offered to us. And so we, yes, thankful for that. The law and the prophets have been brought to completion through the blood of Jesus. So thankful. But I want to just focus in on a different aspect of it, and that's the words that God spoke out of the cloud. That's what I want to just kind of focus in on just for a minute or two. And he said, "This is my beloved son, listen to him." Those three words, right? Listen to him. If we believe this Bible to be true, if we believe this to be the living, active, breathing words of God, without error, do not contradict, okay? If we believe that to be true, then we believe that Jesus is the Son of God. That's what God says he is. That's what Jesus claims to be. As such, he carries ultimate authority as God in the flesh. Therefore, when he talks, we listen. That's how authority works. And we don't make exceptions when the teachings don't align with our feelings. We don't make exceptions when his teachings conflict with what the culture is saying. We don't get to pick and choose just the ones that feel good for us or the ones that are easier to follow. Every single word that he spoke, every piece of his life and ministry, we take that and we submit ourselves to it. We submit ourselves to that authority. We listen to Jesus. We learn from Jesus. We fashion our words and our way of life around Jesus. And as we learn from him, we understand more about him, and then we see his glory more fully. And when we see his glory more fully, it causes us to want to pursue him more fervently, and that becomes the heartbeat of our lives. And then it's just this rhythm of life. It's like I get to know him. I want to get to know him. I believe him more fully. And as I get to know him, I see him more clearly. And seeing him clearly makes me want to get to know him better. And so I get to know him better, and I learn more about him, and I see him even more clearly. And it makes me want to go back and like keep learning. And it's just this cycle that we go through in our life. And it's again, it just becomes kind of like what our life is about, just learning about Jesus, following Jesus, living like Jesus. And then all along the way, we are seeing him more clearly, and we're understanding more about him, and we're seeing some of that glory that he holds. And then one day when we enter into glory and we come face to face with Jesus, this truth is the one that gets me the most emotional, I think, in my life. But imagining, because, yeah, they got to have this experience, but we will too, because we get to be in eternity with him, and we will see the fullness of his glory. We will enter into his kingdom, and we will be greeted, and we will see him, and we will fall at his feet, and we will see the beauty and the fullness of his glory. And we will not just see it then, but we will live in eternity where there is no need for sun or moon, where it will be daytime, beautiful on the new heaven and the new earth. Why? Because the glory of Jesus shines brighter than all. And so I look forward to that day, and I hope you guys do too. Let's pray, And we'll sing together again before we take communion. God, thank you for this passage, and thank you for the truth that we see of who Jesus is and the glory that he holds, the deity that is inside of him that these disciples got to see just a glimpse of. And what this story tells us about what Jesus came to do, that he came to bring to completion the law and the prophets, that he came to suffer. So thank you for allowing us to read and learn from it as well. So God, I pray this morning as we think on Jesus and we think on what he's done for us and we think on what he continues to do for us, that we would be brought to wonder and we'd be awestruck by it. Let us just sit now in these next few moments, just kind of soaking that in and allowing your spirit to speak to us and just praising you for who Jesus is. We love you and we pray this in Jesus' name.